Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
So I think we should get started. It's my great pleasure to have Jake Wabrock over this morning to give us a talk, an update on his latest work and his group's latest work on touch typing on touch screens. And Jake has been a great partner and a great collaborator with MSR over many years. In fact, he was one of my very earliest interns back in 2003. He was an intern at the Surface in the Surface Computing Group.
What? I was only this tall then. I grew up.
So it's been great to watch him progress through his career, and he's now an associate professor at the iSchool and University of Washington, and is kicking butt basically. And so let's hear what they've been up to. Thank you.
Thanks, Andy. So this talk is called From Plastic to Pixels in Pursuit of Effective Touch Typing on Touchscreens. Of course, there's been a lot of work on text entry for touchscreens, and a lot of that work has taken the form of stylus and then, you know, kind of a single finger or thumbs. We're actually looking at, like the picture shows, touch typing. So really trying to get to where we can put our hands down and type as you would, in a sense, on a plastic keyboard, hence the title here. And so part of the questions are, can we do such a thing, and can we do it well, and if so, how? A brief self-introduction, although given the audience, I probably didn't have to do this, but you all know me already. But this is just from the Dub Retreat on Friday, and thank you to all of you who could make it. And I mentioned a couple areas we're working on. Today I'm talking about some accommodating of situational impairments in mobile use. So you can see some images here for some mobile text entry stuff. And then at the bottom, some predictive and adaptive input techniques generally. All of these people here deserve a lot of credit, and in particular today, I'll point out a few in a few moments. So my roots are in text entry. My dissertation work, as some of you know, is in text entry on a system called EdgeWrite that I created and basically put on any device that had edges, and even many devices that didn't have edges, like trackballs and isometric joysticks and even an eye tracker. And you know, I've gone on and done quite a few things since then, but it just seems to be inescapable that text entry keeps coming back into my life, somewhat reluctantly on my part, I'll be honest, but it's still a rich area with a lot of challenge. This was, for example, the four-button version of EdgeWrite, which was really just a demonstration on a number pad of how you could enter kind of gesture text, but without a gesture surface, just by punching discrete keys that correspond to corners. People could write actually reasonably quick, 15 words a minute or so, just kind of twiddling their fingers. The reason this is on the slide, and the reason that this relates to me today, is that even from the unlikely places, I'm still hearing about these things. So this is the setup of a girl, a young woman who emailed me a few months ago about having pain and problems in her arms. I'm not exactly sure what her medical or kind of health condition is. But she's a programmer. She's an undergraduate computer science major. And so she actually rigged up this dance mat to this software in order to write code on her PC. So she programs with her feet as she moves around to actually enter text. So you never know, you know, once you've done text entry, it's like you never know what your future's gonna look like. It's a little redundant with your introduction, but I did wanna mention the similar thing, which is I feel very lucky and fortunate to have worked with Microsoft over the years. It's been, I think, some of my most fun collaborations with including people in this room. Andy Wilson was my manager or mentor in 2003. And then these other fine people here I've also had the privilege of working with and publishing with, and also teaching on the teaching front, some people who don't appear on this slide. Some quick highlights just from that time, some work on modeling pointing errors, a dollar recognizer, that's another one of these things that just seems to keep popping up, for stroke gestures, user-defined gestures with Mary and Andy, access overlays, making surfaces more accessible to people with low vision and who are blind. So there's been some really fun outcomes. So thanks for that, and it's great to be here. So touchscreen typing is the topic for today, and I'm going to cover Probably a little too quickly, but I'm still going to cover five projects, all of which are pretty recent. You can see three of these are at CHI 2012 in a couple weeks. One is at Graphics Interface coming up. And they all hit on different parts of entering text on touchscreens, particularly with this focus on touch typing. So getting to where we're not just sort of single point of input. The real brains behind all this work are Leah Finlater, who's a professor at University of Maryland, Mayank Goel, who's in the room and a first-year CSE student at UW, and Shiri Azenkot, who's also a CSE student at UW. So they deserve all the credit and then some. I want to start with a love story. I'll put love in quotes because it's a story of commitment. I'm not sure it's a love story at all. It's actually a story of commitment. But, you know, we could start by observing how much has changed, right? This is the Daugherty typewriter from 1893, and I like this image because it's so exposing of its guts. You can see into this thing pretty clearly, much more than the ones they used to put in these little, you know, like mahogany wood boxes and things, right? You can actually see the levers and so forth. But, you know, obviously when we look inside today's devices, this is a disassembled iPad, you know, things don't look anything alike. And yet, you know, maybe not that much has changed in some ways. So this is from the 1800s, and here Steve Jobs is talking in front of a QWERTY keypad that's, you know, broadcast large behind him, projected large behind him, and it's in some ways quite amazing. The key arrangement is exactly the same, even over those beyond 125 years. Why do we type? I mean, you know, it's worth stepping back, I think, and asking ourselves this question. What's the deal? I mean, we want to type even when there's nothing to type on. You know, I say nothing in quotes because there's still a surface there, and that's part of our exploration. But this Canesta idea never really kind of came to fruition, but I think there was a working prototype at some level, and, you know, we want to type wherever we are, it seems. One of the answers is because it's fast. You know, if we can parallelize our hands, high-speed camera studies definitely show fingers moving in parallel. We can use nine to 10 fingers because often people don't use both thumbs. Chords are even faster. And just to give you a sense of comparison, cursive handwriting, which is as fast as you can really longhand handwrite, is 25 to 35 words a minute. Stylus keyboards are 20 to 25 words a minute. Touch typing, 50 to 90 words a minute, and natural speaking, 150 to 220 words a minute. And then court reporters can even go beyond natural speaking so that they can catch someone speaking very quickly like I am right now. And they can get even up to around 300 words a minute if they're very good. So if you look, touch typing in here, it's not fast enough to transcribe natural speaking. And if you ever tried to do that, you know you can't quite keep up. But it's still, so far, it's a multiplier of two or three beyond stylus keyboards, cursive, and so forth. Oh, by the way, this image is kind of interesting. These were women typing up Social Security cards, so punching numbers, basically. And the only male I can find in the scene is the guy who probably is doing the least work, you know, the manager type who's strolling the aisle and hawking over people. I think we also type because readers like it. You know, good luck with this, right? So that's from Newton. This is from Einstein. And, you know, part of it's what we're used to in the norms of writing of the day and reading of the day. Perhaps these are even considered neat and nice, but the only thing I can really read is this, because that's printed and the signature, because I know who it is. So, you know, these are challenging for readers. Typing helps alleviate that. Computers like it too, right? So it's a figure from Mackenzie's text entry textbook, but, you know, these are different approaches to dealing with the problem of segmentation in handwritten text. You know, another answer to why we type is because we, quote, always have. So this is the famous Scholz-Glidden first QWERTY keyboard typewriter. And there's no lowercase option here. It's only capitals. You can see it's a pretty minimal key set. But this is where it all began. And we're still with the same layout, which to dispel any myth is to not prevent is not to slow people down. It's actually to alternate hands to prevent mechanical jamming, which is sometimes not
widely. Only uppercase rather than only lowercase?
I don't actually know, but that's a good question. Maybe I'm not sure exactly the time frame. Maybe the telegram era, those messages were all uppercase, and so people kind of inherited this uppercase experience. So the shift key came in around 1922, which from a purely mechanical perspective, you could imagine is a little bit tricky to pull off, right? We love this keyboard, again, in quotes. We kind of hate it, but we love it. We put it everywhere. you know, on places where there's none of this parallelization of hands and all those arguments about it's fast don't really even apply. We even put it here, you know, for accessibility aids when we're using a mouse on a screen, even though actually moving across this space due to the alternation of hands is not sensible. And of course, there's been a lot of work in optimizing that. The Querida keyboard put other keyboards out of business. This is the World One. It's one of the first index typewriters, and it's, of course, gone. This is another index typewriter where you move the lever and you get the letter you want that way.
Maybe you'll get to this.
Yeah.
Is this purely because of sort of historical momentum that, you know, again, it was QWERTY was big and then we continued to get, and now we can't break it?
That's right. That's what I'd argue. I'm not a historian, you know, it's not my sort of main contribution here is to unpack this history, but I think it's, as we'll see, it just caught on and keeps going. And I'll show you actually that in images in a minute. Here's an attempt at lowercase. So there's actually two separate QWERTY key sets, no shift. So that's called a double keyboard. And then let's jump from 1897 and boom, 1968, NLS we've all seen. And there's, you can't quite read the letters, but I can promise you they're the same layout. And the Alto has the same layout. You can read those letters. And the Star adopts the same layout. And on we go, the first IBM PC, the Apple Lisa, and, you know, before long, we're typing on glass. This is a lot different than all those other pictures, right, in terms of the mechanics of the surface we're on. There's no plastic, really. It's pixels, so to speak. It's glass. And it deserves to be asked whether or not we need to type here in the same way, and if so, can we even do that? Can we do it well? So there is a pun on this slide, but I want to make sure no one missed it. The key challenges, you know, some of them at least, are, so there's obviously a lack of subtle tactile cues. There's no bumps, edges, and ridges like there are on a physical keyboard. There's no travel distance. You know, where you touch, you stop, basically, except for the little bit of squishy flesh on the tip of your finger, but that's pretty small. Small keys, fat fingers. Of course, the fat finger problem is known. And there's also, I think, a state problem here in the sort of Buxton 1990 three-state model idea, where with a physical keyboard, I can be off the keyboard, I can be on the physical keyboard, and I can be depressing a key. So there's this three states of action for the user. With a touchscreen, you're either on it or you're off. So you lose an entire state, which turns out to be, I think, a big challenge. This is a cartoon, a little fuzzy, but, you know, this is kind of sometimes how we feel, right? People chuck their high-tech stuff on the floor, and they want to go back to what feels natural and right. So here are some of the ways people have solved this problem, right? They've just attached a physical QWERTY keyboard to an iPad, so they don't have to type on that screen. This is a product called the iKeyboard. I've never tried it, but it's basically a key guard, which is inherited really from assistive technology, but also can help people sort of more accurately hit the keys. Here it is again, although I think it should be noted, this person most certainly didn't write what's on the screen because that's the tale of two cities. And TouchFire is another product. Again, I haven't tried it, but it's basically this peel-off kind of silicone overlay, so you get a little bit of travel distance when you strike a key. But obviously the trade-offs with touchscreens here are big because now every time I want to have the screen display something, I have to take it off and put it back on and kind of fold it back and forth. So there's a lot of attempts and a wide acknowledgement this is an issue. So the idea for today is, can we burden the bits? Can we invert the finger-keyboard relationship? So instead of having your finger subtly adapt to the keyboard that's under it, can you actually make the keyboard adapt to your fingers and just do what feels right? This is hard, and I'm not going to claim that we solved it. But we've taken a sort of first stab at it, and I think future work could begin to chip away further. How well can we actually touch type on flat glass? There's a lot of related work that touches all this. Text entry is an old area. Touchscreens have been around now for a while. I won't have time to review it all, but single point entry keyboards, of course, there's a lot of work there. Adaptive keyboards, often not personalized to specific users, and often actually not even evaluated, just kind of algorithmically proposed. And stroke gesture keyboards, of course, are relevant as well. Not much work, really, in looking at touch typing, like actually trying to touch type. It's just not been as approached. And of course, on a really small device where a lot of this work began, touch typing is compromised by just the lack of space. Okay, so in looking at kind of the five projects, we're going to start with a study of finger strikes. How do people actually strike glass? So this is this first part here. How do fingers strike glass when trying to touch type, and what are the implications for touchscreen keyboards were the questions we're interested in. So actually was sitting next to Stu Card at HCIC last June, and I, boy, it doesn't show up in the projection too well. It's too bad you can't see my screen. But there are a bunch of smudges on here. And they're actually really indicative of the underlying touchscreen keyboard. And you can see, and it's just, I just looked over at him and he turned off his iPad, but he'd just been typing. And I looked at the iPad and I saw the shimmer because the angle I was at was just right. And there's a full keyboard here that you can see. And I thought, hey, Stu, take, you know, can you take a picture of your iPad? I'd like to see the emergent kind of keyboard from your finger smudges, your oily fingers, right? And so he did. And you know, it kind of reveals that that striking glass does, of course, form these patterns. And of course, when he's doing that, though, he's looking at a keyboard. Here's from online, I found a site that actually put up some smudge images. This is from a mail program, and you can see the typing layout here a bit, and then some scrolling behavior from smudges on the side. This is a Photos app where there's a lot of swiping in the center, and then Angry Birds, which I've never played. But if you've ever played Angry Birds, maybe there's, is there something about, yes? Okay, so I figured someone in the audience would know, and I figured, okay, I'm going to do that, right? But maybe I'll have to play just to see what the motor patterns are. So, you know, it's interesting, these kind of physical traces we leave, right, as we interact. So this is a Surface that was generously donated by you guys, by Microsoft, thank you. And Daniel Wigdor helped get this into our lab. So we did build a little stand to get it higher because touch typing like this is a little tough. So we wanted people to be able to sit and be a little higher. And so, as I said, this is primarily a study. How do people strike glass? There are three conditions. Today is going to be a bit of an overview, so I apologize that I'll go quickly. It's not going to be the level of study detail that you'd find at a Chi Talk. So if you have questions, we can deal with those or talk about them later. But there were 20 touch typists. That was inclusion criteria. They were 85 words a minute on a physical keyboard, so they were actually good typists. They were transcribing phrases, and there were three conditions. There was one where there's just no keyboard and no feedback at all. And then these were counterbalanced. That came first. These were counterbalanced after, which is no keyboard and then some asterisk feedback and no keyboard, and then a keyboard rather, and asterisk feedback. And I'll explain the asterisk feedback in a second. We don't have a recognizer here trying to figure out where they're striking, right? We want to just know where they strike. So you can't actually show letters unless you choose to show the right letter every time, which is also maybe problematic because it gives maybe a sense of confidence and accuracy they didn't have. So to explain this condition a little bit better, again, with no keyboard and no feedback, we present a phrase. These were areas just to register the thumb, so they were kind of in a comfortable starting position. So they were prompted, the input area, and then the users could configure those thumb placements as they like. Here's what this looks like. So again, no feedback, just typing on glass. You can see that the hands actually start down, and then as they begin, they kind of hover them slightly. That was a sort of natural behavior we saw. But the palms and arms are resting, which is, for a vision system, another thing you have to make sure you ignore, spurious touches and so forth. Okay, so then the next condition was no keyboard with asterisk feedback. So they're actually going to get some feedback in the form of asterisks that help them stay aligned with the text. The one character you are seeing that we did input is the space. We had a big kind of space bar area that was reliably hit. But otherwise, we're just showing when the system saw a strike so that they can stay aligned. So that's what this looked like. And of course, you know, there's no recognition of what those strikes are, just that they are. And that's why yes, we did have backspaces in the form of right to left swipes, which of course is not the same, not as ecologically valid as reaching for a backspace key. But the reason we did that is we wanted to go with what we thought probably would be more likely of a reliable way to backspace on a touchscreen, and also not to confuse it with potentially striking like the P key, which is in the direction of backspace. People found that was comfortable enough. And then the third condition was actually with a visual static keyboard. Okay. So, you know, again, this asterisk business, let me briefly explain. If there's a strike, you know, there's a question, right? Is this an I? You know, is it a mistake? Was it spurious input? By showing the asterisk, we kind of resolve that for the user, that at least we can believe that they can believe that they're in, you know, entering what's next. So it helps correlate those. And then if they actually made a mistake, like here, it didn't catch the space or they did not hit the space area, we ask them to stay aligned. So they would actually backspace through that word and begin again, and we would disregard any miss like that. So the result is we can correlate input events with the letters. So here's some of the other data collected. We can see that we can see all the fingers down there. That's an, for example, would be synchronized with an A, that touch. This might be synchronized as well. We can see the hand down, so we have touch down and up events. And we also did some simple, you know, computer vision stuff to grab convex holes and things, although I won't be talking about that today. So some of the results we found. So here are all the key presses from the whole study. And everything that was a finger or thumb is blue, and palms are, and spurious kind of stuff from the palms are orange. And you can clearly see some patterns here that emerge. So one, we can see the separation of hands, right? That's fairly obvious. Another is that there's a heavier use of the right thumb than the left, which is typical for right-handed participants, and all of them were. You can go back to your office and see if you do that as well, but, or maybe you can imagine, you know, kind of feel it here, but that tends to be typical. There is a nice arcing of this top portion on both sides, actually, and that's kind of interesting because it suggests a certain sort of configuration to the would-be keys. And then you can also see these kind of split trends, these sort of curves that come down through the middle here. The typing speed was 58 words a minute, which is about 31% slower than their physical keyboard rate of 85 words a minute. And this is just, you know, with all those touches. So breaking down, if we look in some of these, what I think are kind of pretty pictures, actually, we can see that with the visible keyboard, you know, they're obviously, their key centers are aligned pretty well with the intended keys. Without the visible keyboard, there's just overlaid for illustration now. You can see it's a lot sort of cloudier. There's more dispersed, as we might expect, right? And the speeds, though, are about the same. So 27 words a minute, 28 words a minute. These weren't significantly different. So obviously, if you're going to type with no visual representation, you're going to have to account for some spread there. We can do one standard deviation contour ellipsis and look again at the structure here that emerges. The visible keyboard and non-visible keyboard here is on the right, and some comparisons. So we get more arch on the non-visible keyboard. We also get greater space between the hands. That was typical across participants. And larger key press spreads out near the extremes. So, you know, when you're not drawing a keyboard, you get these effects that are kind of magnified versions of what the visible keyboard allows for. And I think we kind of just reinvented this, or rediscovered it, you know, which is actually kind of good. I mean, it would be a bit of a surprise if it was wildly different, but the same patterns actually are very much present there. We did some, yeah.
Can you just go back one?
Yeah.
So there's those big enter keys and things on the left, those big keys. Are those A, does that correspond to A over there, or does it actually correspond to the enter?
No, right. These are only be letters, I'm sorry. They're not tab, caps lock.
So well,
yeah, I know, that's right. And perhaps, you know, what we see here is that these letters, there are some, I'm sorry, let's see. This keyboard doesn't show them. Some keyboards have bigger keys on the outside a little bit. And they're beginning to go that way. So that's an older split keyboard. I think the newest ones would show something more in that way. If we actually do some very simple key press classification, just the distance to the centroid and some tenfold cross-validation, you can see that with a user independent, so across all the subjects, we get about 93% on the visible keyboard and only 70% accuracy on the non-visible keyboard. That's obviously not even remotely good enough to type on, but that gives us something of a kind of user-independent baseline. If we personalize to different users, so here's three of them, for example, we can see, you can see the split here between hands, it's kind of interesting. We actually come up quite a bit. So it's not, I don't think this is the case where we would insist these things have to be user-independent. I think personalized can make sense because our systems can observe our typing and create models for us. So that's just distance and centroid, and we're going to see as we go, through this talk that we do quite a bit better than that as we get more sophisticated with our classification. You know, so what classification accuracy is good enough? And does a visible keyboard that obviously was better, more practice? These subjects just started. They didn't have practice. There was no real practice here. More sophisticated touch model, perhaps a language model. We're going to leave language models out today. They could be overlaid with any of these techniques. So we'll explore these. So we went on to look at actually personalizing keyboards in this way. Leah Finlater was the main author on this. And so we're here now. You know, and so I guess in a way we're trying to see if we can get away from this situation, right? This is, at least with our experience of the surface, the pass around the keyboard thing is a little bit clunky, and there's nowhere to set it really because the margins aren't that big. There's been some really nice work on keyboards on surfaces done by people in this room, the three of the four authors I think are in here along with Bjorn Hartman. And this is I think, really interesting work, but there's a much bigger surface here, and there's multiple keyboards, and people have their own, and so forth. So it's a little bit of a different problem. So better classification, you know, how can we do here? So distance and centroid, I think, did show some promise, you know, 90% or better, but it'd be nice to do better. So we took more people, more data from different keyboards, and more transcriptions. I'm moving quickly over the gathering of that. That's okay. But here are what the features were that we kind of ended up exploring. So with a given touch, a down-up, you know, we have the usual features you might expect, the fingertip, the finger center, some travel between the two, the angle between the two, and the major and minor axes and so forth. So these are some possible features per touch event. And trying to figure out which key does that touch event map to, that's the question, right? So through some wrapper-based feature selection, we ended up with the starred items. And they're not real surprises. The tip of in the x-coordinate relative to f and j. We do everything relative to f and j because they kind of provide the sort of origin, if you will, because we want the hands to be able to kind of split wherever they go. And so you can see some of the others there. Now, there's a big question here about, do you actually show the adapted visual representation, or do you just adapt the underlying model but don't show it? And I actually think this is kind of an interesting question. It's certainly been raised in adaptive interfaces generally. Do you kind of show the model or not? But when we're typing, we want something, touch typing, I should say, we want something that's very motor driven, right? So how much you show is kind of how much you maybe lean people towards looking. And that actually came up. So there's at least three challenges here. Let me describe this. This is an adaptive keyboard, but the layout remains static. It's just going to stay fixed. Here's one where we're actually showing the underlying adaptation model, right? Of course, you can't really show everything because there's some features that aren't just X and Y centroids, so it's an approximation, but it's closer to showing the model. So you get this kind of cycle of adaptation, right? So the visual representation changes. I think it kind of looks like the continental United States here. Then the user changes their behavior to compensate, and then so the system adapts again, and then the user, you know, and you end up with this kind of cycle that's been observed many times. And what happens if someone aims a key press, like deliberately aims? And that's what Tim Peck is unfortunately sick today, but he's been worked on some of these problems and developed these key center anchors to avoid that problem. Our approach here was just to disable the classifier after a backspace or when typing is slower than a keystroke per second. And we found that worked fine, but these are complementary approaches. Another issue is excessive overlap. So, you know, keys can become very overlapped. If you look here, what's next to G? I can't even read. F. The F key is really kind of, it's with an underline, right? F is a bit hidden there, and other keys as well, J as well. So we actually maintain a minimum of 30 pixels between the key centers. It's just a change in the visual space. It's not a change in the model. We kind of push out from the F and J keys to do that, and that way things look a little bit cleaner. So the process is, you know, start with a static layout that's seated, and then we, as the user types, we observe those key presses. We use a decision tree classifier. It was trained on those features you saw. We use Weka to do this. Optionally adapt the layout of the keyboard. So the underlying model, but not visually, as we just talked about, or showing the visual portrayal. And then things get, as you can see, kind of crazy. That's right. So we're not, and that's, I think, a good point of future work is getting much more sophisticated on those kinds of relationships. Yeah. So here you can see an image of the keyboard. And in this case, the person's hands are spread to the point that the two halves have gone with them. You could type like this if you wanted. I don't think that would be very ergonomic, but, you know, it's able to do that. I unfortunately don't have a video of the keyboard in action right now. But so we did do an evaluation, and so we had touch typists again. Their physical keyboard speed was 79 words a minute. These aren't the same people as before. Each key was initially seeded with 5 points. Adaptation starts at 10 strikes per key, and the history per key was about 100 strikes. And so we had a phrase transcription task for the training and learning, and then also pangrams to make sure that enough of the Q and Z and so forth were given enough data. It's a phrase in which every letter in the alphabet is contained at least once. Quick brown fox jumps over the lazy dogs.
What's the other one?
Something deeper is vex.
Yeah. So that's right? Pangram? That's not race car. Race car, palindrome. That's the other. They both start with P. Different. Okay. And then we had three conditions, keyboard conditions. So three levels of the keyboard factor to formalize that. So we had an adaptive keyboard that did not visually adapt, as we talked about. We had the adaptive keyboard that portrayed that visually, and then just a static conventional keyboard that did nothing. 3 1.5-hour sessions, and so they acted as lightly longitudinal. They came in 3 times for a total of 4.5 hours, and 4,500 phrases were collected. And what's nice is we actually have a significant effect of the keyboard type on words per minute, and what we see with that is that the adaptive keyboard that did not visually portray its adaptation was faster than the other two. And you can see that's even from the start. The visual one kind of starts at a deficit, gets a little bit better, and then by the end, and we don't know if we could go further if this would continue to improve, the visually adapted one. But the non-visual one was the winner. Let's see what speeds are around here. It's, you know, over 30 words a minute. The uncorrected error rates were near zero, so we didn't statistically analyze those. There's just tons of zeros in that data. Some preferences were expressed as well. These are from the NASA TLX scales. We did a kappa to actually see that they were only measuring about three things, so we grouped them. And these are the ratings from these participants. A lot of people preferred the non-visual adaptive one, the one that they were fastest with, but they actually indicated that the natural kind of comfort was owing to the adaptive visual one. Of course, this response could be because they thought it should be more natural, since it's visually adapting. We don't know for sure.
Are there so few respondents on least frustration?
Right, so this is one scale's worth of responses, so there's 12 people. This is 24 because there's two scales, and here's 36, yeah. Sorry, I know I'm blasting through some of the finer details, so please interrupt me if you care. Some comments. I felt I was constantly looking at my hands about the adaptive visual keyboard. 8 of 12 participants actually made similar remarks about this. Not in session 3, though, so they did seem to be getting used to it. The adaptive visual keyboard seemed easiest this time, as long as I didn't look and see the odd spacing. So it's ironic, right? If you adapt it visually, they don't want to look. So why bother, right? Why do that? Because they're freaking out, like, whoa, that doesn't look right. It's kind of like, turn your head and it's okay. It's kind of an interesting trade-off there, right? Most subjects preferred the adaptive non-visual keyboard, but did not really know why. Because remember, this had no visual distinction from the static conventional keyboard. It appeared to them exactly the same as that. A quote here is interesting. With the iPad, you see the wrong letters and it corrects in front of you using language model correction is what they're referring to. But with the adaptive non-visual keyboard, I know I'm hitting in the wrong place and the right letter comes up, which is nice. I'm just not used to it. I think there's some interesting thoughts here about whether or not to adapt visually and what the benefit really is there.
There's something you're doing with the visual representation here that you haven't commented on. I mean, I look at these things and they look like little Gaussian blobs.
Right.
So I'm wondering if you explored the sort of the design space of that, like to actually make the representation correspond to the distribution for each key and therefore sort of change people's expectations about whether or not they really struck the key.
Right. So that's a good observation. So the distribution of hits that we think belong to a key are trying to be reflected by what we're drawing. I wouldn't say we really explored the sort of visual representation options that might be possible, and that's actually an interesting point for future work. Yeah. I mean, we're trying to suggest there's not these sort of rigid boundaries like old school containment hit testing, you know. There's definitely room to move on that. We also saw another pattern, which was that people's adaptation with a visual portrayal was greater than without the visual change. So this is the non-visual one, but now rendered visually. So you can actually see kind of how much there was adaptation going on. And you can see it's more subtle, whereas this is for the same participant, but with the visual representation. So it's as if you don't actually show the visual change, they don't actually necessarily move with as much variance. If you begin to reflect the visual change, they move with more variance, perhaps feeling like they have to reach for keys as they get further out, and then they enter this cycle of I'm reaching, and it's driving things further out. That's still a bit of an open question. So in summary, we learned a few things. We did improve the typing speed over the conventional static keyboard. Subjectively, it offered good performance, but participants couldn't really tell why. So that's kind of nice because they don't know. And we'll see that happen again with WalkType a little bit later. We seem to require more visual attention with the visual adaptive one, but perceived to be comfortable and natural to use. But maybe that's a novelty effect. So I think we can do more with touchscreen keyboards than just touch type. They afford certain other things. This is not gestures for cussing, despite the title here. Yes, Sherry?
So I'm not very familiar with Microsoft Surface, but is there a keyboard?
Yes.
In the standard?
Just a static, yes.
And it's not like a Windows Phone type keyboard or a Windows tablet type?
Not to my knowledge. It's there might be such a thing now, but back in the day, does anyone know?
Yeah, like it predates all that stuff.
Yeah. So it's, I think it's just transplanted from the desktop.
You can reorient it, that's about it.
Mm-hmm. So maybe there's some room to improve. I'd like to talk a little bit about using touchscreens for what, in part, they're good for, which is actually making gestures and strokes, and actually adding that as a complement to some of the mode switching we're used to. So I know this is not from a Surface, this is from an iPhone, but how do we find equals, right? So we go here, and then we go here, and we find it, hopefully, if we know even to look there. But the point is, we're doing a lot of mode switching and flipping the screen. Now, on a small screen, that makes some sense because you have limited real estate. But I actually think that we can draw, right? I mean, we're on a surface. Let's draw things. So here was our idea. Four or more fingers go down on the offhand. And then on the dominant hand, in this case a middle finger, but it could be any finger, we just simply draw what we want. I actually am not sure we even need this, but we didn't kind of get far enough to explore, just leave the mode out and just draw. But certainly that helps disambiguate. Your hands stay in typing position. There's some nice gestural affordances of this. It's also kind of consistent with Yves Guyard's kinematic chain, frame the area, act in detail inside it. And so you can see some of these here. You'll notice they're multi-stroke, and in fact, we even have multi-touch gestures as well. So some of those benefits, it's an active mode. That's another nice one. So you know you're doing it, like shift, low visual attention. You don't have to really look. You can feel. And in fact, you can keep your eyes on your text that you're entering, and participants' comments reflected that. We used, to design the gesture set for punctuation, we used the gesture guessability approach that I'd used with Edgewright and Mary and Andy. And I used for the surface gestures study and work that we did in 2009. In this case, you can see we had 20 participants and a bunch of different punctuation that they were and symbols they were working with, and then also some commands, space, shift, backspace, and enter. And we allowed them to do single touch, multi-touch, unistroke, multi-stroke. That was all open. But they were stroke gestures, not like sort of palm of hand and things. Here's the agreement scores, which some of you are familiar with what this means, but it shows a sense of consensus around the gestures. We had one trial where we just showed the name of the symbol, so asterisk written out, because if we showed an asterisk, that might bias them towards making that kind of asterisk, right? That typographical mark. And then in the second trial, we showed the name and a symbol in many different fonts, kind of like 10 fonts of asterisk. So we're trying not to bias them towards a particular representation. And you can see there's some good agreement in the beginning here, question, dash, pound, colon, a few others, but then, we plunge into the commands being way down here, shift being the least. Here's some examples of shift. So you can see that people are coming up with different things. This probably is a four-finger upward swipe, two fingers one side or the other. And so people come up with different things. And then comma and period were low enough and common enough we decided to leave them on the keyboard. So this is the final gesture set and actual gestures from real participants. You can see some of the variation we'd expect with this guessability maximization. So the dollar sign with one vertical versus the dollar sign with two verticals and so on. We did decide, based on what we saw, that the preponderance of multi-touch gestures, not just multi-stroke, which many of these are, but multi-touch, multiple points at one time, for these gestures was high enough to recommend that they be included as multi-touch gestures. So equal sign, colon, two fingers, right? The pound sign with two fingers slashing both sides and then quotes and things. But most of them are still single touch, single point of entry. We also added some marking menus. So if you're on a key, a letter, and you want to, say, shift that key, I think there were an I or something here.
You did use multiple gestures for each one. So for instance, equals might be this one or this one.
Yep. Mm-hmm. That's right. So they're aliased just according to whatever. Yeah, that was just, So that's part of what that guessability procedure gives you, is kind of anything people come up with. As long as it's not colliding with something else, it can be included, right? So this marking menu idea was just another addition where you can hold down on a key and then stroke, and that gives you, for example, control A or shift or whatever. So we evaluated this, but we needed phrases that included punctuation, obviously. So we actually just did word pairs and inserted punctuation between them. If it was the kind of punctuation that needs a partner, it would be partnered at the end. Six participants did this. We had two keyboards. Gesture versus a mode key, like you'd expect. And we're not, this does not have to live instead of a mode key. It can live with a mode key in perfect harmony. So it's really a complement. It doesn't need to be sort of better. It just needs to be good or useful or whatever. So, you know, the goal here was to not really sort of replace mode keys necessarily. But we found no statistical difference on either errors or speed. In fact, they were almost identical. So that, in a sense, means it's not any worse. I do think we had enough statistical power here, so we would have seen a difference. Some comments, this is great, it feels very seamless. My opinion of gesture, yeah.
I have a question about the mode key condition.
Yeah.
So can you go back to the picture of how the mode key works?
You know, I actually don't have a close-up of the mode key, but what it was there was a symbol key where the shift key is on a regular keyboard, both on the left and on the right. And then when they hit that, it would switch the key labels.
The keyboard, they would get a keyboard.
Yeah, the label, well, the key. Yes, sorry. I know I'm going fast.
Okay.
This was not evaluated. This is just another cool thing you can do with gestures and touch keyboards.
Okay.
Sorry for the confusion. The study was just of the mode key versus, a shift key, basically. And the keyboard keys didn't move, but the labels on them flipped to the...
Another question that I have then, the way the mode key condition works is, so I know that like on the iPhone, for example, the reason they switched to the keyboard choice is because it's so small. But in theory, on the surface, if you want, you could just have like a wicked big keyboard that was one keyboard that had them all, maybe they're just harder to reach.
Right.
Was that
around the top, around the sides?
Was that something you considered?
We did not, we thought about it, but we did not decide to make that trade-off or that evaluation yet. Mostly because we thought there are so many symbols and things that if you do that, you just end up with this kind of ugly, I don't know, we were skeptical people would really use such a thing. It's kind of an aesthetic more than anything, not a real principled rejection of that idea. But certainly just that you're in a Fitts law, just you can almost model that one, right?
Well, but you can imagine at least having every single symbol, but the symbols that are present on a real physical, the symbols that have dedicated keys on real physical keyboards, if you're doing kind of the analog to the real physical keyboard, right?
Right.
Some of them still require modes to get to, but some only require one press.
So I guess you're talking about the sort of six or so that don't require shift, that have their own key.
The ones that are above like the number keys. Anyway,
it's a fair point. Right. Basically, the question we had was really driven by, do you switch the set or not? And you're saying, with enough real estate, you don't really have to switch the symbol set. And I think that's a fair point, yeah. Thankfully.
Do you have any thoughts on the timing required for actual mode switching to your gesturing mode? Was that sequential or was that kind of done in parallel?
So, I'm not quite...
Putting four fingers down.
Right.
So, did people kind of make... Like put four fingers down, then draw, or was it more like in the middle of drawing? Did they?
Okay, the two hands. Right. No. So actually, they not surprisingly perform just like the kinematic chain theory would suggest, which is that the one leads the other. We didn't do. I don't. We have the data, I guess. We didn't look at the exact timing between the two hands hitting.
Do you feel like
one led the other?
That you potentially don't need the moding, right? Like, you can quantify how much time they've wasted on putting four fingers
the first,
down,
right.
What would you? Foresee your next slide being winning?
Yeah, I don't know.
I'm just curious.
Right? You're right. So I have two comments on that. One is that the hands were already in place, so dropping the four fingers was just a matter of vertical descent. It's not really, it's a very small, unaimed task. It's not, it's really pretty incremental. Yeah, sure. The other thing, though, is that, I guess in a sense it's a little bit misleading to present, not misleading, but it's a little bit off the point to present speed things here because, people find, if they found stroke gestures much more satisfying and more comfortable or something like that, right, then I think that is easily warranted adding such a thing, even if the speed was, say, a little slower. So, yeah, it's always nice to be faster, and I think that's possible, but I'm not sure also they have to hover their offhand if we didn't have the mode, right? They have to put their hand somewhere. So I'm not sure that resting it's any... sort of worse a choice than hovering it or whatever, right? Let's see. My opinion of gesture things is that there's a slightly higher learning curve, but they're usually faster once the fingers know how to do them. That's the learnability question. For the mode key keyboard, I always had to look down at the symbols to find where they were. With the gesture keyboard, I felt I didn't have to look down really at all. If I did look down, it was just to figure out if I was on the home row. So to Mary's point, if you actually had all the symbols on the main keyboard, there still would be visual search time and learning of position, but you'd learn it over time, just like you have to learn gestures over time. Yeah.
The people who did this experiment, the comparison, are they the same people who created the user-defined
No, sorry.
Set?
No.
You said
yeah, yeah, yeah.
Now. And did you?
Yep. Learning?
You taught them the available set, or did they just guess?
I didn't say this because I'm moving quickly, which I think I've learned a lesson, which is if you say it, you'll actually go faster because then you prevent questions. they only had 3 to 5 minutes of playtime, basically, for practice. So it was pretty unconcerted. And I would say, actually, having seen all this, that there was a very guessable set. There was almost never something they tried that didn't work, you know? So I guess, in a sense, it validated the guessability procedure again. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about mobile and situational impairments that still involve, you know, trying to type on touchscreens. And of course, now we're not talking about 10 finger, we're back to 2 fingers, 2 thumbs. But I think it's sort of unfortunate that our devices have very little awareness of the context in which they're being used. You know, we move through the environment, and as an accessibility researcher, as part of what I do, I'm actually really interested in how situational impairments actually cause accessibility needs for all of us. So we're actually impaired by the situation, by the context, by the environment, not just sort of because we have a health condition of some kind. So, for example, when you're walking, probably beyond this, but you at least have divided attention at some level, some body motion, which also could be part of vibration, or maybe you're moving and something vibrating. Maybe you're in an elevator or something. Uneven terrain like stairs, ambient light levels, ambient noise levels, all these things kind of fight for your attention and resources. There's been a few studies of this stuff, but really very little innovation. So it's not that uncommon to hear people talk about these, but then it's like, well, what do you do about it? And there's almost nothing yet. So I think it's pretty wide open. Yeah.
Walk application?
I'm sorry, which one?
Email and walk.
Email and walk. That's not one I've come across, actually.
Okay.
Yeah, maybe we can talk and you can send that to me. If there's a... Okay. Email and walk. So is it accommodating for some of these?
Just make sure you don't run into pillars.
Yeah, right. Exactly. I actually... well...
You mean like it uses the camera on the phone to tell you...
Yeah, so that you can see where you're walking, right? I have heard of that technique. Yeah, okay. So that's actually maybe one of these rare points of innovation as well. So quickly to what WalkType is, go straight to the heart of this. This is Mayank Goel's work. So how it works, it uses touch features from the touchscreen features, accelerometer features, inference about gait, which I'll talk about in a moment, and key center anchors, which I mentioned earlier, coming from Tim Peck and others here, to actually cut the text entry rate in half while you're walking, which is... The idea here is that if you actually do dynamic resizing of keys, whether, you know, well, mainly thinking about when you do that such that the motor space of each key is changed but not the visual portrayal, then you can get keys that are almost impossible to hit because they're so crowded out by the keys around them that are more likely. And so key center anchoring is to preserve the center point of each key with some little space so that if a user deliberately aims a strike onto a key, they'll get that letter. It prevents keys from being blocked out by their neighbors. And the insight here is from how the device is moving, we can infer how the user is moving. And how the user is moving systematically causes errors. And systematically is why we can do this, because it's actually somewhat kind of lawful.
I don't know if this is relevant. Yeah. Are you familiar with some of the work like on image deblurring?
Yep.
Because it seems really similar in spirit.
It is. And Mayank will tell you all about that after we're done.
Awesome.
If you want. Yeah. So it's kind of image stabilization-esque, but for sort of input, right? As opposed to output. Right? Do you want to, I mean, you're here. You want to say something more about that?
I think that's right.
Okay. So you're not meant to absorb this whole slide. I know it's a lot. It's actually a set of different models that were tried, the classification models from the left across the top to the right. The right is the key center anchor feature, but these indicate the features that are being used in these different models that we explored. And I don't have time to go, you know, if you want to see this in detail, come to Kai, because in a week he'll be talking about this whole thing very much in depth. But there's touch features that are green, there's these accelerometer features that are blue, and I just want to focus on one here, which is the phase of gait, the kind of gait phase, the walking phase. So here's what we saw. It turns out that when your left foot moves forward, the device slightly rotates counterclockwise, as this arrow indicates. And then when you were intending to say, for example, hit S, you've got a little rotation and you land on D. This was a systematic pattern that emerged. And similarly with the right foot forward. And so because this is somewhat systematic, we can actually do something about it. So this is x-axis acceleration. And if you actually take the mean of this signal, and then you can tell that sort of below the mean actually does correspond to left foot behavior, and above the mean corresponds to the right foot's action. And if you fit the dominant frequency here, we take a feature of its amplitude as one of the things we care about. And we also take a feature from the x-axis crossing to the touch point. So these dots are the touch point, the moment of touchdown. And those time elements indicate kind of where we are in the dominant frequency. And so what happens for classification then is if the key center is struck, the anchor trumps all. So you get the key, guaranteed. That's the idea from Tim Peck and his co-authors. But if not, then we have these different models, and I'll show you their performance individually in a moment. But we have the Euclidean model, we all know, this distance to the center, acceleration and displacement model, and then this walking pattern model, which includes those gait features, which I just briefly mentioned. And so the majority wins there. So they each make their vote, and if there's two out of three or more, that's the classification of the key. If they all disagree, then this one wins because it was the highest individual accuracy. And we used a decision tree for this as well. So if you look here, just briefly, it does start at 75, so or 70. But you can see that the walking pattern model is individually the best. Touchscreen features only without the accelerometer does okay, but not as good. And then when we put the last scheme I just showed you together, we call that walk type, and that does the best. And so an evaluation of this, with 16 participants, two keyboards, walk type was on or off, but visually there's no change, so the participants don't know which they're using. Two postures, we actually did sitting and standing, 30 phrases and 57,000 key presses. The words per minute while walking is improved. I actually think this is due to the prevention of errors, so we're not spending time correcting errors. And you can see here that actually sitting, the mean is higher, but that wasn't statistically significant.
Why is it's just sitting the walk type helps?
Right. So that's a good question. Actually, let's talk about after I show the next slide. Here's the bigger result is that the error rate while walking is halved. And so there's a win there. But again, the error rate's lower while sitting too. And that goes back to your question, why is that improved? And then you can see here, this is the same data without walk type. You know, those red dots are off the key that they were intending, and here they're kind of cleaned up. You still have some, but not as many. So we can leave this slide for a second. So why does it help when sitting? So it seems that when you're sitting, there's still some of the same kind of body motion that happens a little bit in a subtler way as when you're walking. So as I move, you know, without the step, the sort of major thing, I still have a little bit of, you know, body perhaps. There's some still noise in there that gets cleaned up a little bit. Did you want to add anything to that? Yeah.
When you type, like, the device is still rotating over.
Yeah, just a little. So, right. So the stepping exaggerates that, but the hands are still part of that story, right? That's obviously a very good question. Thanks for asking that. On the user preference, we saw that 14 of 16 users preferred walk type, and again, they didn't know which keyboard was which, right? They just used both. They looked the same, and they said, oh, I like this better. That was a better experience. The last project I want to touch on is typing for blind people. And this is called the Perkinput system that Shiri Azenkot, who's here, has worked on. So a couple questions. Can we lower the visual demands of text entry on touchscreens to zero? Like really zero? And if so, might we have a touchscreen text entry method that's useful for blind people? So this is a Perkins Brailler, and it's a text entry, in a sense, entry, text creation device that if you know Braille, you can use. And so you place your fingers here. So here's the Braille letter for P. So Braille's six dots, if you don't know Braille. It's six dots in two columns of three each, two columns and three rows. And the Braille dots I can number in that way and then map those to the Perkins Brailler. So we would have our hands, three fingers on each, and that's a space indicator in the center. And so with two devices, and I'll show you, actually we have multiple versions, but if I use two devices, they would map very straightforwardly, as you can see there. And in fact, we have three different versions. So we have a one device, one-handed version. So this is the same hand acting once for one column and then a second strike for two columns. So two hits per letter. In this case, the letter R is shown here, the Braille R, and you can see that those fingers match the same. And then two-handed on two phones, you just saw that. two-handed on a tablet, you would see that. So these are straightforward mappings to the Perkins Brailler, whereas the top one you hit twice. But it's the same mapping within each hand.
A user begins typing by registering reference points.
The pinky is being used to enter the space, since that's not a standard Braille finger on the Brailler.
A user can also enter text on a phone twice as fast using two phones.
Connecting.
So this is a process of providing registration points where the hand, where the fingers will be.
Perkinput can also be used to enter text on a tablet.
Her fastest phrase on the tablet was 57 words a minute, which rivals touch typing for many people on a physical keyboard. But it's still a long way from a stenographer's, you know, situation, but it's yeah, Braille-based input. Yeah, so hit testing, I put in quotes because it's not the kind of conventional sort of containment style. You saw the registration points. What we do is based on maximum likelihood, assuming Gaussian distributions around these reference points. And so if you have one strike, it's pretty straightforward to take the key whose probability is most likely. But if you have two, you want to maximize that over the two. So if you look at this figure here, you know, the combination of these two points in their respective distributions is what gives the overall highest probability. So quick evaluation here. We did, the evaluation wasn't quick, but I'll quickly go over it. It was actually fairly long. Sherry's like, no, that cost me 3 weeks of my life. It was a longitudinal study to start with. So we had kind of three phases. And the first was the one-handed version, because most people are going to still just have one device, against Apple's VoiceOver, which is something of the kind of main state-of-the-art competitor, I suppose. We had eight subjects, but they came eight sessions. So we had a fair bit of data from those. And then in a second phase, we took one of those people who was willing, and was she the one in the video? I think she was the one in the video, yeah. And she went on to do six more sessions to kind of gain more expert proficiency. And then in the third phase, she also went on, the same person went on to do two more sessions on two devices and on the tablet. So we're getting a picture there. The words per minute, VoiceOver was not, frankly, very competitive. That was sort of what we expected, but that was borne out. And you can see that over the six sessions or so, or the eight sessions rather, the participants on average were almost eight words a minute. Not super fast, but this is the one device version. Things will speed up considerably as we add devices or space. Uncorrected errors was also much less than VoiceOver, so we don't have a speed accuracy trade-off, which is nice. This expert in her extended use went on, the axis here is not to 10 words a minute, now it's to 25, went on to be, I think her peak session was about 17 and a half words a minute, which is not too bad for a single device, for also, a single touchscreen.
You have to keep in mind that she's getting audio feedback every time she touches the screen.
Right.
So that also slows things down.
Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah, so there's this delay to hear the feedback,
yeah.
Right? So it's not just a motor kind of performance outcome. And then in the two-handed devices, we have these results. So this was that last bit where she did on two devices and then on the tablet. You can see with two hands on the tablet here, words per minute is in the, I think it was 38 words a minute. And her fastest phrase was 57 words per minute.
Do you think it might help for a follow-on to give audio feedback once you have the word completed?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
But as a starting point.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, that's on the next version stuff, you know.
Why is there a discrepancy between the two devices?
Yeah, exactly. And actually, let me come over here, because in the uncorrected error rate and corrected errors, you can see the errors made during entry. Both of those cases, the two devices is a fair bit higher than the tablet. Actually, I'll let Sherry answer that, because I'm not sure.
We only did one session we had one practice session and one real session with the two device setup and the tablet setup. So the two device setup we did second. She was tired. Like, I could see when I was sitting.
They were confounds there. Okay.
Time. Yeah.
So maybe that's not as stressful. I wasn't aware there was a fatigue thing going on. I actually wasn't sure if you notice when she used the one device, she actually used her offhand to stabilize it a little bit.
That's true too, yeah.
And with two, you can't, right? And so there might have been a little shimmy.
There was an issue with the device.
That's what I thought. They would explain that.
But I do think that fatigue played a role because we only did one session.
That's good to know. So Braille-based input can be quite fast, 38 words a minute. Two hands on a tablet were faster and more accurate than two hands on two separate devices. But I guess that's deserves an asterisk now in light of the potential confound. A Perkins Brailler can be simulated with just one hand, but speed suffered. So going forward, just to wrap up here. So we talked about these five projects, and they're all, you know, concerned with the same issue of touchscreen typing. But what have we actually learned? Yes, you may. That's why I brought you today.
Okay. Just one more tiny thing that's kind of cool and wasn't demonstrated is that she can, let's say she's typing with two hands on the tablet, she can easily switch to one hand by just registering only with four reference points in the one hand. So it's kind of cool. We could like type with two hands and read, if you want to read Braille with your other hand and transcribe it, you can do that too, and you can switch back and forth.
It would be useful if she wants to actually hold the tablet and type.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right, right.
Yeah. Any ideas about doing a flute interface? Seems like uniquely suited to your three finger plus three finger space.
So actually, there's a
mention other interfaces that way, but all jokes aside, I think it's actually quite.
No, right. So actually, there's a project. So you may not be able to tell quite, but he's holding the screen towards us with his hands on, right? So we know what this is like.
Yeah, yeah.
So there's a project at Georgia Tech called what they call Braille Touch. Yeah. And that's actually the orientation they picked. And they're coming from both sides and doing it. Their paper hasn't, an evaluation hasn't been published. We don't actually know. I don't, maybe you do it by now. I don't know how fast that worked out to be.
But it seems like your dual hand input could be very easily mapped to this. You have to account for some finger actually being there all the time to hold it, probably pinkies,
right.
And then pinkies could, other fingers could be on it.
That's very much the posture they
So I think the key insight here is that we're not using fixed head testing. So I think there's definitely some exploration we can do with different postures. The other projects that have done something similar, they just split the screen up into three regions or six regions.
Buttons, basically.
I agree that there's more we can try out with this, but I think that the key thing that we've done so far is just to develop this technique of using the reference points and inferring which fingers are touching the screen based on those reference points. Cool.
Thanks, Sri, and thanks for your question. Okay, so what have we learned? I think we've learned a few things. I think we've learned how fingers strike flat glass when touch typing, at least something about that, the distributions, the kind of shapes and patterns that come from that. We've learned how adaptive keyboards might use features beyond just touchdown location to classify strikes as key presses. So touchdown is just really one kind of feature, but there's these others we can use, and we put them to use. How adaptation can be visualized or not, and some of the issues surrounding visualizing that actual underlying model. How text entry speeds can be improved through adaptation. So we saw with the adaptive keyboards a significant improvement in text entry speed, which is actually, I'll highlight that. That's the first time that an adaptive keyboard study for touch typing, and I'm not sure, it might, probably not in any possible keyboard study, but I know for the few touch typing attempts out there have never shown an empirical improvement. So this is the first time that we've seen any actual benefit of adaptation in terms of actual text entry performance. So that's nice. How gestures can be used for punctuation and how marking menus can be used for commands. How accelerometers can be used to halve the error rate of text entry while walking and also improve the speed, I should say. That's another benefit. How a Perkins Brailler can be simulated using one or two devices with one or two hands, and that actually people are, on the whole, relatively comfortable typing on flat glass. And when we started this work, we weren't even sure that was true. So, you know, it's not all that horrible to do this, especially with just a little bit of getting used to it. Yeah.
Have you or others looked at all at how adding things like audio feedback to the flat glass typing experience would also help?
We have not done that, and I think there's just so many dimensions of this. That's another point of good future work, which is basically
not even audio, like you hit A, but just like click, like because you're missing that
right. Ticks, even slight little haptic vibrations from motors or things, or if you could get. I mean, it's harder on a big surface than a device, but you know that's probably. Could you make the screen vibrate just a little bit? I think that's all open for exploration.
Android does that now.
Yeah, that's an option that on their small device. But I actually think in the touch typing sort of 10-finger space, that's actually a really interesting question. If you can make the screen feel like it gives just a little, you know, I know there's the piezoelectric approaches to that, but even just with a little vibration or something, that might change things a lot. I don't know.
Yeah, most of your approaches reduce the fingertip to a single point, mm-hmm. and then you kind of aggregate that over time, right? You're
yeah.
basically looking at the distribution of those point hit testing.
Right.
Have you looked in any of your features or any of your explorations not considering finger as a point but as an area touch? And then corollary to that, I mean, there's a lot of work from, you know, Patrick Bausch's Christian
yeah.
Holt, like understanding touch of like where exactly that point is, right?
Right?
It's not.
Yep. Yeah. Mary's actually lecturing on that in my class.
Right, right. So, but I wonder, like,
yep.
it seems like everything that you're doing right now is a kind of step above that. I'm just wondering if
well,
like, introducing those points, those features.
Yeah, so. Right, so I'll remind, let's see, I think I can, it's worth maybe popping back. Sorry, I don't know how easy this will be to do. Maybe if I go this way. I'd like to show you the features that were selected because you'll notice that, here we go. You'll notice that a few things at least that begin to get towards area, not area itself as a single scalar, but major and minor axis, for example, right? They speak to that. And they weren't actually that useful, at least in this particular approach. I'm not saying they couldn't be in other ways. So, and then there's a little bit in terms of the actual movement of things, although you're right that it's being measured from different coordinates. One thing about the touch, perceived touch and so forth, is that, you know, my understanding is that that work goes to what a human thinks they're doing when they touch versus what the system's able to say, actually, you're touching here, according to the way it's sensed, right? In this case, it's a little different, right? Because the points are consistent, even if I don't feel like those are the points I'm hitting. And so if I'm able to just type, especially with something adapting, I don't actually know quite where the keys are. But the points, as long as they're consistently represented, it should still, I think, produce an outcome that I want. So I don't know how much we'd get from that or not, but this is becoming a theme. But I think that's also actually a worthwhile sort of next step. To look at that a little more closely. This is definitely sort of machine learning light, right? I mean, WalkType was more sophisticated, but the rest of this is kind of a first cut with sort of simple approaches, like Andy's comment about things aren't really being correlated across multiple strikes and so forth. That's all very true. I think with more expertise there and some more digging, that things could get better. But part of the take home is this actually is not that bad. I mean, it's actually giving improvements. We're getting better words per minute. We're getting better accuracies in the case of WalkType and stuff. And so if we're already doing that well now, if we actually beef that up, think it's only going to get better, right?
I guess my question, I wasn't so much looking at adding more features in your,
okay.
your feature table. But more looking at basically area-based approaches. Like you basically
okay.
get these heat maps of coverage of where you are.
Right.
And right now you're considering hit testing a point against those heat maps, right? And moving that point and moving,
right.
you know, looking at a Gaussian from the heat map.
Yeah.
But in general, like, you also have this information about the actual touch. You might have this information about the touch itself, like the area of
mm-hmm.
touch and how it was there and maybe the point of impact and all sorts of other stuff there
right.
that you might use against your, in your hit testing against these areas. Maybe that will give you,
yeah, okay.
I mean, it could be potentially much more
yeah.
informative than a single point.
Yep. I see what you're saying.
Point.
Okay. Yeah. Sorry. I kind of missed your
no,
point.
No,
the first
okay.
time
I think this was part of the question as well.
Okay. 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 Yeah. No,
we
haven't looked at that. I'd love to talk to you more about that actually. That sounds like a nice next step.
Okay.
So thanks for the suggestion. I know we're kind of towards the end here, so let me just, drive us down right to the end here. So for future work, including some of what you guys have mentioned, I think we touched on a few things here. I think there's a tension between inventing entirely new methods for sort of text entry on touchscreens and surfaces and versus just, can we make the Qwerty experience really good? I mean, part of my initial part about all that inertia behind Qwerty is it's fun to go try brand new things, and I think it will be new in the sense that perfecting Qwerty is going to require new things, but it's still kind of the same old Qwerty. It's like, how much do we yield to that versus try something just totally new? Bimanual text entry techniques haven't really been fully explored, I think. I mean, especially if we go in the new way, touch typing is obviously bimanual, but are there ways we can use two hands in interesting fashion that can make, larger touch surfaces useful? This hasn't been explored as much because on small devices, it's not as relevant. Is the stylus making a comeback? So the Samsung Galaxy S, I think, or Note, the Galaxy Note, right? It's like, oh, that looks like a Palm Pilot, except it's nicer screen, what are the implications of that? I'm not sure, but I think it's another thing to think about. Better understanding the cycle of adaptation is kind of a general problem, but I think it does raise its head here quite a bit. Language models' effects on typing behavior. So we avoided the language model. We actually have one working, and it actually does pretty well. I kept that completely out because we wanted to isolate the sort of touch-based approach, but we can add a language model on top. But what are the effects on people's typing behavior is a fair question. Better features and classifiers and different approaches, like Benko was saying, is certainly part of future work. Can we touch type on a phone-sized screen? It's also a little bit of what you were suggesting, Benko. But even in a QWERTY fashion, is there a way to do QWERTY on an iPhone? With maybe hands in kind of interesting ways, but you could kind of cram them in there, and could you get good enough? I'm not sure. That's kind of owing to the inertia of QWERTY, right? Is that right? I mean, right. Which WalkType was about, but. And then additional sensors, which for some of you in the room is like your hotspot of expertise, but what kind and for what? I'm not clear exactly on what else we could get, and I'm sure there are answers to that, but that would be actually interesting to think about. So another way to put the challenge less textually is just this way. So, all of this, right, is trying to solve some problem, and the question in a succinct fashion is, can we just do this somehow without feeling the need for any of those things, right? Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Mary's so excited she didn't even want to clap. I take that as better. I take that as better. That's better than applause. You're just okay. Well, people may want to leave, but if you want to ask real quick, and then feel free to leave.
You were asking about additional sensors. So I had a question, which was if your phone. Have you? I don't know if it would be valuable or not, but like with the front-facing cameras, like is the whether the person is looking or not important? Because that seems like it would be add to the confidence of whether they're hitting the right place.
So actually, I have a project sketched up in an NSF grant about using the camera looking at the person to figure out different situational impairment stuff, right? And I haven't thought about it, though, in terms of improving the text entry accuracy. But that's actually could be a really interesting sort of feature to add. Yeah.
Look up, it's almost like kind of tightly touch typing, and so that probably...
Right, so my general thought was could you kind of implicitly mode switch things in a way that's more comfortable and natural by whether the person's looking or not. And even when you look back, take Patrick's phosphor technique, right? So that I can see the last thing I did, my eyes are drawn to it, right? If you're familiar with the green glow paper. But I hadn't thought in terms of text entry. It was actually interesting to think how would or could the sort of model or the keyboard or whatever change in a way that's useful. Certainly you could take up the rest of the screen. I mean, I don't know if you'd want to move your hands, you don't look up and move your hands around, but if there's a way that you could reuse parts of the screen or something, because when you're not looking, you don't need to show anything, right? A project I did with Sean Kane a few years ago, I was mentioning before the talk, called Slide Rule, was for blind people to access touch screens and kind of screen read with their finger and do a split tap, what Apple calls a split tap now. We called it a second finger tap. But that was an exploration we had, and we just drew nothing to the screen because, they're blind and for sighted people to have that same experience. So I think when you're not looking, there's maybe ways to reappropriate the screen, but text entry is such a sort of heavily motor-dependent, fluid task that it's not obvious to me how we might do that, but it's an interesting question for exploration, yeah. Yeah.
So Skema, I want to talk about that a little bit, because I recently have got some contact into the Steno community.
Okay, right. Okay.
And they think we're all idiots.
Yeah, okay.
Because they're like, we solved this problem.
Yeah,
The answer is Steno.
Right.
You can,
court reporter, stenographer.
As you pointed out, they go at, conversational rates easily.
Yeah. Yeah.
They say it is the, it is something that takes some degree of training.
But go to school for it.
Yeah. You get licensed. There are tests.
Right.
That you have to be up to, I think it's 250 words per minute to get a licensed stenographer.
So the range I had was about what they'd agree with, yeah.
I mean, they think we're all nuts for not adopting.
Why aren't we using Steno right now?
I don't know. Actually, one reason that they give is they said that the machines are too expensive. Mm. So that they run $6,000-$7,000 a piece.
That doesn't seem like a real. So did the first typewriter, right?
Yeah. Well, and so there is this group, there's an open source movement doing this program called Plover, which is open source steno. So you can do steno on standard keyboards. And this is how I found out about it, because one of our keyboards is one of the few that actually lets you chord large numbers of keys simultaneously for cheap. You know, it's kind of funny because I'm talking to them, like some of the applications they push out. So there's a lot of people who have had throat cancer that can no longer speak. And to be able to converse at, you know, kind of normal conversation speeds, they teach them steno.
So basically for output purposes, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
And being able to, you know, buy a $30 keyboard and be able to do steno, you know, is incredibly enabling.
Sure.
It seems like the improvement is worth the pain.
Yeah.
Whereas Dvorak never seemed to be a worthwhile trade-off. It's these sort of alternative layouts.
But given how much we all now spend, you know, our time communicating via text, do you think it'd be worthwhile? I mean, should we be teaching our kids?
Well, I think it's a good set of observations because there, and I've done this too, it's often dismissed out of hand because, oh, it's too hard to learn, whatever, right? It's a learning, it's an expert thing. And we can't all expect to be experts, and we can't, right? But I think that is a bit of a punt, because if we did teach it in school, right, you could imagine, I mean, we teach our kids a lot of things, right? So if it were worth it. I guess I have some skepticism around its mapping to an iPhone-sized device, you know? And I have some skepticism around some of the other kind of translations from its original, you know, use, particularly in the court situation or other cases, not just for that. But so I think in the case of the throat cancer person, right, that's obviously a case where you have a highly motivated person who for whom it's really worth it. And I just don't know that we're there yet. I mean, I don't need to, I can't think that fast probably to write any faster, much faster than I would use a QWERTY. So it seems for communicative reasons it might be better than, but not necessarily for like me in my office doing steno into my PC or whatever.
I wonder if one of the main problems is that there's such a high barrier to achieve some useful level of competency, whereas with a QWERTY keyboard, you start
hot
off
and pack.
With a hot and pack, and you can
that
still
might
be.
Right. You can't hunt, that's true. You can't easily, in the same way you wouldn't hunt pack. I mean, the Braille type, I'll get you into a second, Mary. The Braille type, the Perkinput work, and the typing Braille, work is obviously meant for a certain kind of profile of user, which is someone who either knows Braille or is willing to learn Braille, who's probably blind to begin with or has a reason to have learned Braille. And so there aren't actually very clean statistics on how many blind users actually know Braille. I've seen very different, I know that seems surprising, right? But do you have any insight into that? We've talked about this before, and it's
I haven't
unclear.
Been able to find anything about the number of people knowing Braille now, but there is, right, because speech is so available now and it's available for cheap.
Learning rates are going down.
Yeah, there are fewer children learning Braille, which is a huge problem because they're illiterate basically.
Yeah.
So it's kind of a chicken and egg problem.
Yeah.
Being a naive user, the one place on-screen keywords are really bad news is typing passwords on a phone. Have you any insight on that? Because, of course, don't do language model when you do passwords. And they insist on uppercase and numbers and special symbols. And the whole thing is a postage stamp.
Yeah.
And Windows Phone won't even let me go landscape.
Well, part of my answer is stay tuned, because Shiri's latest work has been on something very much related to what your question is, and I, at her request, I'm not going to say more right now.
But there has been some.
She can say more if she wants.
There has been some other work done on autocorrect for password entry. If you Google fast words, it's what's that guy's name?
Autocorrect for password?
Yeah.
Seems a contradiction in terms.
Yeah.
I know.
No, you meant to log in with this.
Yeah, that was just filling for you.
Yeah.
I can send you the paper if you want, but I'm also I'm working on something that's
okay.
A different paradigm altogether. But I don't remember the guy's name.
Sorry.
I can send you.
One thing I did a couple years ago was actually see how well people could log in with a single sensor, single button or touch, if you will. So the password became, instead of spatial, which is really what our passwords are now, became temporal. So you tap a little song, like a jingle, you know, happy birthday to you. Turns out people's individual differences on their down and up times are pretty clear. So we don't actually internalize that song in the same way, and our timings for, if you only time down, they're more similar, but if you look at up, when people release their finger.
So they're all using the same tune?
Yeah, and it turns out to be really hard to eavesdrop. So just a quick aside, Mary's arm's gonna get tired, but I will call on you. Now you know how our students feel, right in our class. So we had people do this within like a foot of someone looking, knowing what the song was, and then trying to replicate and log in against their model, and no dice, it only worked 8-9% of the time, something like that, which is too much, but if you're giving them the perfect eavesdropping situation, right? So you could log in on an iPod Nano or something if you ever had personal information on that, like, or anything with just a button or a single touch point or capacitive sensor or something. But it's a song, it's a temporal. It was called tap songs instead of passwords, right? Tap songs. Anyway, so I think there are some innovative work, not just mine, certainly, in sort of alternative password approaches, but...
Yeah, but all the sensors on their own rules.
Yeah, yeah. Mary, okay.
Well, now I have two questions. So I want to know about your tap words, which is, so you're saying, you know, there's a lot of individual variation, which I totally believe for regular people, but I'm wondering, did you test it at all on people who are actually musicians? Because I imagine that musicians would have actually much, maybe more...
Yeah, refined, sort of.
Refined and similar...
So they could sort of eavesdrop each other better, maybe, or... log in against each other's. Yeah, we didn't do musicians. Other than in all my development, I'm, you know, an amateur musician for many years. So it was, I played, the piano and the guitar for many years. But and so I don't know. I mean, my sense is that the timings might get a little tighter or something.
Were you telling me about what drummers? There's been some study on drummers and their ability to detect discrepancies in time is much higher than that. Wasn't you?
Sorry.
It's actually...
I know trumpet player as well. I can tell you about that.
It seems quite plausible.
Yeah, so there's actually a whole field called the psychology of music, and some of the earliest references that I actually spent some time with were from the early 1800s. So this is 1830s and so forth, about basically rhythm finding, because it does tell you something about transmission time from the brain to the hand and things when they're working out neural transmissions. And, you know, if you think about it, tapping with a signal with like a beat or something means you actually have to fire things before it arrives or you're late, right? So they're kind of isolating some of those things. I never in any of that time saw a specific musician-oriented kind of how good are they compared to the Joe Schmoes of the world, but I'm sure that exists. So it's actually like their book's this thick on psychology of music, and it's kind of motor control meets music. It's interesting.
My other question was just when we were talking about steno, you have to invest a lot of time to learn. I was actually maybe curious for even touch typing. I mean, what percent of people can touch type? Like, I feel like we live in this weird world where we're all nerds.
Yeah.
And we have a touch type. But maybe not.
I don't know. Gosh, that feels like quite a gaping hole in all this, doesn't it? I've never been asked that before and didn't ask myself. That's the blind spot, I guess, right? Like you said, we're all in this room at least pretty good touch typists. Okay, most of us. Most of us. Yeah, but many of us anyway, I should say. Yeah, no, that's a slightly embarrassing.
1% of people or like 90% of people can touch type? I have no idea.
But what do you consider touch typing? Just not looking at the screen and using the correct, like the standard finger to key?
I imagine those are pretty closely related.
Not necessarily.
Not necessarily.
Yeah.
I don't touch type, but I can type it out of the other keys.
Yeah, because people have...
Like, I do
mean you
type.
Do it, you have a non-official way of touch typing.
Right.
Oh, interesting.
That's all. So the question is, how many people are formally trained in it? Mm. I mean, did you?
School
districts would know.
So I would consider myself a touch typist, because I don't have to look at my hands. I don't even know which fingers I use. Maybe some of them are non-standard. I think I use my pinky for the P, but sometimes I think I use my ring finger. I was, you know, never formally trained, and I suspect that anecdotal description is actually one applicable to many people.
So you'll have to find this out and tell me later.
Okay.
It's your homework.
You're giving me homework? Okay.
Tomorrow at class, I want to
Okay, one last question from...
Dr. Colin.
Yeah.
When the light's on, I consider myself a touch typist. When I can't see the keyboard, I find I'm easily one key off
right.
At the laptop, so there's no... indication.
Yeah, so a couple years ago,
we had
a project a couple years ago, actually. Now I have to say one last thing and then we'll close, I promise. I know you're all hungry and so am I. But a couple years ago, we had a project I did with Sean Kane in 2008. It was a paper at IUI, but it's called True Keys. And it was motivated by a computer science professor at UW who's an emeritus professor, but his son works at the med school. And this father, former computer scientist, had peripheral neuropathy, which meant his fingertips were a bit kind of numb and not very sensitive, and he couldn't sort of feel the bumps and ridges and all the things we've just been talking about. And so he would often land on the keyboard being off a row or column or whatever, and he'd have that experience that we've all had at some point where you're just off completely. Mm-hmm. And so we developed a system that took keyboard geometry into account, physical keyboard geometry into account, and could rectify that. And so you could actually be off a row and it would just work. So that actually happens occasionally. I'm not sure if that's solving the world's greatest problem, but it was a fun project. Okay, thanks a lot. You don't have to clap again.